Happy Tuesday, everyone. Don't touch that dial. Don't touch that remote control. Don't go water the chia pet. Don't take out the garbage right now. Don't fill up those ice trays. Don't answer the cell phone. I want you to sit back, relax, and enjoy. You know why? It's time for another episode of SCIU Says. I'm your host today, Charlie Bonds, and I have a guest today. Introduce yourself, please.
My name's Karen Sheely, and I'm an attorney with the American Civil Liberties Union.
All right, we're going to have a really good show. You know the rules. Get a pen and a piece of paper and get ready for a whole lot of information. It's time for SEIU Says. Enjoy. All right. As always, we thank you for allowing us in your home, or if you're streaming us live off of the internet, we thank you. SCIU Says is sponsored by GWC, that's Goldberg, Weissman & Cairo, Illinois' largest personal injury and workers' compensation law firm. If you have questions about workers' comp medical malpractice or personal injury, give SCIU Local 73 a phone call, and that phone number is 312-588-7630. That phone number is 312-588-7630, and we'll forward you right over to GWC, Goldberg, Weissman, and Cairo. All right, I have another announcement for our members. If you work for the Cook County Division, it is going to be time to ratify you guys' contract. So I don't know if you can actually see that. So, so Cook County workers, all of our Cook County employee workers. So if you work for the Markham Courthouse, if you work for District 5 Highway, if you work for the Juvenile Detention or Domestic Violence, if you're on 26 in California, the Maybrook Courthouse, District 2 Highway Department, Rolling Meadows, the 911 call center, the 911 center, also... Yeah, we got 26 in California. All right, so it's time to ratify you guys' contracts. So, you know, the collective bargaining agreement has passed, and now it's time for you guys to ratify your contracts. So voting is all of this week, and this is for all the Cook County employees. So voting is all this week. So if you need information on that, it's social media time, everyone. That's right. It's social media time. So we want you to go visit our SEIU Local 73 website. That website is SEIU73.org. That website is SEIU73.org. And today's Tuesday, so Wednesday, April the 8th, from 6:30 a.m. to 7:30 p.m., that will be the District 2 Highway. Also, you can vote at SEIU Local 73. You can vote there as well until... Friday. Actually, it's you can vote until Friday. We're open from 9 a.m. until 4 p.m. Our address is 300 South Ashland, and you can go to the third floor and let them know you work for the Cook County Division and you would like to vote on your contract. All right, so you want those voting addresses and those times, you can go visit our website, please. All right, so we're going to get right into the show. This is a very important show today. We're going to talk about stop and frisk. All right, so my guest today, Karen, is an attorney, and she works for ACLU. And what does that represent? What's the acronym for ACLU?
The ACLU is the American Civil Liberties Union, and we work to protect everyone's constitutional rights, from police practices to reproductive rights to people's First Amendment rights. We do all of that kind of work.
Okay, people's First Amendment rights, and First Amendment rights are very important.
Yeah.
Okay, so... Chicago is known as Second City, but we're not the Second City no more. Second City as a joke. We're number one when it comes to stop and frisk from Ferguson, Missouri, New York, Los Angeles, as well as Atlanta, Georgia, New Orleans, and other places around the country. People are being targeted. Americans, innocent Americans, are being targeted for stop and frisk. They're going through the humiliation of being packed down by the police or to make feel that they've done a criminal thing in which they are innocent. And so we're going to talk about those things, and we're going to give some statistics. We're giving some numbers, and we're going to talk about, is it legal to record them on a cell phone? Some people say it's not. Some people say it is. So we're going to clear that myth up. What happens when you are stopped by the police? So unfortunately, as you see, so many people's lives are disrupted. What's going on? What can you do? It can happen to any one of us. All right? So sit back and relax. All right. So we're going to just start with a simple question. What is stop and frisk?
Well, stop and frisk is a police practice where police officers are allowed to stop you for a short detention, and they're supposed to be limited to just doing a pat-down on the outside of your clothes to see if you're carrying a weapon. They're only supposed to do it if they have reasonable suspicion that you've committed a crime or about to commit a crime, and they're only supposed to do a pat-down if they think that you're dangerous and carrying a weapon. We know that it doesn't usually operate that way, though.
Right, it doesn't. Okay, so reasonable suspicion is if they feel.
If they think that there's reasonable suspicion and they can point to facts. It can't just be you seem suspicious. It's got to be you seem suspicious because you're walking out of a store with a TV and the sirens are blaring, or you seem suspicious because I've just seen you hand a packet to someone and it seems like a drug deal. It's got to be tied to facts that tie you to a crime.
So that's important. So walking down the street is not suspicious.
It shouldn't be suspicious. I mean, it may be that there is an APB out, like that you need to be able to then fit the profile.
Right.
It can't just be you're African American and you're walking down the street. Unfortunately, that often is what happens.
I was just saying what happened to me. Yeah, me, right. The police, right. Whoever thought. Okay, so this is how I knew that he was not a good police officer. I was in a suburb. Where was I? I don't remember where I was. And I was coming out of the White Hand Pantry, and he asked me for my ID. And I gave him the ID. But first he called me. He called me Jerome. No, he really did. Where was I? It's a western suburb. I can't think of it. I get it. But he called me Jerome, and I'm not Jerome. He kept saying, "Hey Jerome, hey Jerome, hey Jerome." And so of course I knew what he was trying to do.
Yeah.
And so I said, "Well, I hate to disappoint you, but I'm not Jerome. So here's my ID." And so I gave him my ID, and he ran it. And I don't have any, I'm not a criminal or anything like that. And so I said, "Well, what was the problem?" And he said, "Well, you fit a description of something that was going on." And so this was my test, I felt. This is how I knew that he wasn't there to serve and protect. Because if he was, I think he would have said, "Well, you know what? You're not the criminal, but be careful because and keep your eyes open because there's something going on out here." But he didn't, so I knew that he was, so.
Yeah.
So that did happen.
I'm sorry to hear that happened.
Oh, that's all right. Yeah. I'm pretty sure a lot of people at home, that sounds like a Sesame Street story to some of the stories that are affecting people and plaguing people around the country.
Yeah.
But go on.
So, yeah, we're hearing stories all the time about people who've had this experience, who've been stopped by the police, who maybe have multiple stops throughout a day because they're the community that they live in. And, young people who are trying to get ahead in school, try to make the right choices, feel like that they're being targeted, and that's a real problem.
Okay.
So we're concerned about this.
So I want to go back to that. So it shouldn't be. So walking down the street is not making you look suspicious.
There has to be something else. There has to be something else going on.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So if you walk with five people, can they say that's mob activity? Because that's a lot of times how they try to get people.
I guess the context of where you are and what's going on matters. The police do have a right to disperse people who are on certain street corners if they're designated hotspots. But to do a stop and frisk of everyone there, you need to have reasonable suspicion of criminal activity.
Okay, we have a caller. This is SEIU Says.
Good evening. And may I say, Charlie, this evening you have a very gorgeous guest. First of all, I want to say,
what's your favorite food? You want to take out the dinner?
What is a terry stop? Okay. What? And I will ask a police officer. I was involved in terms of a terry stop, and I asked them, is this a terry stop? And they were telling me they didn't have to answer my question. I said, fine. Okay. And they were telling me that I was being hard to deal with. And they would say, I can arrest you. I said, people know me. Go ahead, arrest me. Okay, that's what I say, arrest me. I ain't gonna say nothing else.
Yeah.
So he asked me for my ID. I gave him my ID. And I said, is anything else, whatever, And he said, no, whatever. You know, I was telling him that, okay, if you want to frisk me, fine. You can frisk me, whatever, all right? But the worst thing I think people do, do not get in an argument with the police officer. You're not going to win it. If they want to search you, whatever, fine. Because the place to adjudicate that is a court of law. I gave you some free advice. You don't argue with people. If you have an issue, don't argue with that police officer. A court of law is a place to adjudicate your case.
That I completely agree. I mean, our recommendation, it sounds like you've figured out the right formula there. Our recommendation is get yourself through the situation that day, and then if you feel like your rights been violated, you can call us. We have an intake department, and we would love I'd love for you to call us tomorrow and let us know more about your story, and for other listeners who've been stopped and frisked in Chicago to give us a call, too. Our telephone number is 312-201-9740, and we're happy to consult with people who've had a stop and they feel like their rights were violated.
I was in Downers Grove. Downers Grove is nice besides that, but okay. All right, so, okay. Okay, so my next question is, it's not illegal for a police officer to stop and frisk you, and we kind of went over that. So.
Yeah, they just have to have the reasonable suspicion that you're involved in a crime.
Okay, we have a caller. This is SCIU Says.
Yeah, good evening to y'all. Now, you probably already got, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You probably already heard about this. Well, this guy was in New York City. I think he took his horn, and I think this police officer had got upset with him. Because the police officer had a bad day. And then he needed off the street. They always talk about the bad guy needed off the street. The police needed off the street. Hello?
Okay. You're right. Okay, the phone dropped. All right, okay. So do you think that...
Okay, the phone dropped.
So I read the report. What's the website for people in all over? Well, how can they obtain that report?
You can find it on our website. It's mm-hmm. ACLU-IL.org.
Okay. Read the report. It's really good. All right, so why do you think the training for police officers is so inadequate in minority communities?
You know, unfortunately, it's not just minority communities. It's okay. All throughout the city that we're seeing that police officers, police officers are required to write down why they stopped someone. Mm-hmm. We reviewed a sample of mm-hmm. those stops, and we found that in half of them, they weren't writing down reasonable suspicion. Mm-hmm. They weren't giving a good reason. So we mm-hmm. think it's a training issue throughout the city. Mm-hmm. Yet there's more stops in minority communities than mm-hmm. in other communities around the city. Mm-hmm. But when you get to the white communities, we were talking about this earlier.
Or Downers Grove.
Yeah, we don't have the numbers on Downers Grove, but we've got them on like near North and Town mm-hmm. Hall and Jefferson Park. Mm-hmm. And in those communities, even though black people live there, mm-hmm. more black people are stopped in proportion to their population. So this is a citywide problem.
Mm-hmm. Right, because I know some of my friends, we say that if you can drive through a certain suburb, sometimes you're lucky. Like, you know, things with Evergreen Park. Okay, we have a caller. 1 second. This is SCIU Says.
Yeah, good to see y'all again. I just had called him.
Okay, yes.
And I said, this guy, he was driving. I said he had blew his through his horn. And the police officer got mad about him when he had a bad day. Hello?
Right.
And then after that, he had to go to a funeral.
Okay, we can't hear him.
Yeah.
Okay, so, all right, so do this, so that's my next question. You ahead of me. Okay. So the Chicago police, do they follow the proper procedure? So there's a procedure when you get stopped and frisked. Yeah. Okay, what is that procedure?
The procedure is that after the stop and the stop and frisk has to be based on reasonable suspicion of criminal mm-hmm. activity, mm-hmm. and when the stop and frisk is over, if it doesn't lead to an arrest mm-hmm. or to a ticket, mm-hmm. they have to fill out what's called a contact card.
So they fill out it in front of you?
They just have to fill it out.
Because I'll ask.
Yeah.
You fill the card out, and I'll get thrown in jail for asking.
Yeah. One of the things that we think the reforms that we're asking for is that we think you should get a receipt.
Right.
You know, so mm-hmm. that you know for sure that it's been filled out, that mm-hmm. you know for sure that the reason's been being written down, and that you can see that the reason that the officer stopped you. You have some information about the mm-hmm. stop, and it would also make it easier for people to make complaints.
Right.
So we think that's really
passed.
Important. Yeah, we want to get that recorded. That's really important information, we think.
Okay, so they should fill. So with this, out of the 250,000 stops that happened last year, they didn't. A lot of them. A lot of those cars weren't filled out.
Well, what's crazy is we know, and when we're talking about the 250, it's from May to August of this last summer. So it's just really a short time period. Wow. There were 250,000 stops that didn't lead to an arrest or a ticket. So these are people that the police officers stopped them, they checked them out, they probably patted them down, and they didn't think it was worth arresting them or giving them a ticket. Mm-hmm. So these are people the officers decided is an innocent person that's going to go on their way. Those 250 are the ones that were written down, but we've talked to people who have made complaints about stops in the past and asked for their card, and then it doesn't show up in the records. So we know that there are more out there. Yeah.
And a lot of people don't want to just go through the headache of it.
Yeah.
I'm a union rep, so I like to fight. So I challenge you. Like, yeah. I will challenge you. I will ask you.
You know what your rights are. You want to make sure that they're enforced. That's
exactly.
Good. I hope that all these union members are thinking that way. It's a good approach.
Okay. So with these stops happen, were Chicagoans civil rights violated as a result of that?
You know, I think that the data indicates very strongly that people's civil rights were violated.
Okay.
Because we aren't seeing justifications for all the stops. And we also know that African Americans are being stopped out of proportion with their population. And those are two things that are strong signals that civil rights have been violated.
So if your rights are violated, what should you do?
We would love for you to call us. If you go through one of these stops and you have a question about whether or not it was legal and you want to do something about it, give our office a call. It's 312-201-9740.
Okay, this is SEIU Says. We have a caller. Happy Tuesday.
Good evening. Maybe your guest can elaborate a little bit much more on the reason why police officers love to stop you and take you through certain changes. One, when a police officer says and find a gun on you, guess what? They get a day off from work. When they arrest a person, they have to wind up going to court. If they be in court just for 30 minutes, whatever the case may be, guess what? They get a whole day's pay for doing that. And a lot of people have to wind up going back and forth to court two or three times because the way the system is, that's the reason why a lot of times police officers, they love to arrest people because they get rewarded from it. They have those sort of types of incentives. I hope your guest will elaborate a little bit on that. If you would, I appreciate it.
Okay. Well, you know, thank you for commenting on that. I guess there are general concerns about all kinds of arrests too. The report that we focused on is really about being stopped in the street and kind of the daily humiliation that a lot of people are going through and facing these stops, even when you're not involved in criminal activity at all. And these aren't resulting in an arrest. So,
I didn't forget one time this happened. This was up north. It was Chicago. It was okay. But I didn't forget. A police officer told me one time that it may not be the case now. This was maybe like about 7 years ago that in certain neighborhoods, they have to meet a quota of tickets. And when the people are good in the neighborhood, the police will start looking for you to start so they can meet that quota. So, like, I was actually up north in Rogers Park, to be precise. I was over on Morris. So y'all may know what that is. But I was hanging out up on Morris. And, and whatever. So the police, we were talking, whatever the case may be. And he said that, this is a high crime area, but tonight is good, but we still have that quota to meet. Mm-hmm. And so when there is no crime, they'll be proactive and start to try to look for things. And I guess that's when the people start to get pulled over for the tail light. And that's when the people may start to get pulled over, just for something, the minor things. All right. So question. What should you do if you are stopped by the police?
Well, if you're stopped by the police and you're not sure whether, what the situation is, I mean, the first thing you should do is stay calm. You should follow police orders unless it's asking for information. And you should, the first question you can ask is, am I free to leave? And if the officer says yes, then leave. You can leave. If the officer says no, then that means that you've either been Terry stopped or you're under arrest. And, then the next thing you need to do is just get through that situation the best that you can. Follow police orders. You know, you do never have to consent to a search. You don't have to consent to giving your ID unless you agree to do it. You don't have to give it.
So you never have to. Okay, but what if they pull the gun on you?
Well, you don't have to agree. You have to do
it. No, because I've got all these stories.
Yeah.
What do you do, Charlie? No. It's weird. I was with one of my friends. And he was my barber, and my barber's kind of in a very interesting neighborhood. And so we drove up, and just this particular day, I didn't bring my wallet with me, but I had my ID because I didn't want to bring my wallet with me because I was in this neighborhood and I didn't want to get robbed. So, but we was in a car, and so I had my ID with the things on me, and so they came up to the car already with drawn guns on us.
Yeah.
And he was like, "Where's your ID?" Where's your ID? Well, I have the ID, you know. But
were you driving?
No, I wasn't driving. I was in the passenger side.
Yeah.
I was in the passenger
you
side.
You have to give it if you're driving.
Right.
If you're in the passenger, you don't have to give it.
Oh, but he asked me. He was like, I guess he asked me. No, I'm sorry. I didn't have the ID with me because I didn't have my wallet because I made a joke to him. I was like, well, I didn't bring it because I didn't want to get robbed like that.
Yeah.
And so they pulled guns on us and they asked for the ID. So I guess what the question is, you said you don't have to show them the ID, but what do you do if you have a gun pointed to you?
Well, the difference between what your rights are and what you end up doing on needing to do on the street, if you're in a situation where with an aggressive officer, that's two different things.
Mm-hmm.
They can definitely ask for your ID.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not driving, if you're just walking down the street, you don't have to give it. But obviously a lot of people do because they feel very intimidated.
Mm-hmm.
Police officers can ask you for your name and for your identification in general, but you don't have to give it.
Mm-hmm.
If you're afraid, if you have a gun pointed at you and they're asking for it, I understand why.
So now you should just I get what you're saying, but in cases like that, it's like literally a life or death situation.
Then you need to get through the situation.
Mm-hmm.
The things that, really, I can't stress
enough. And that's sad,
though.
We're talking about this in America right now. We have a caller. This is SEIU Says. Hello?
Hi, hey. How are you this afternoon?
Excellent. How are you today?
Okay, I'm good. Okay, as a union member, and I've been a union member for 7 years, and I've been calling for about 6 months pertaining to a question about my job.
Okay.
And no one has returned my call, and I have been paying union dues for these 7 years.
Okay.
I work for healthcare.
Okay, that's not us. We're SCIU 73. That's SCIU HCII. So you need to talk to them when it comes to healthcare. Okay? Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you. Okay.
So, I was saying that I can't stress enough that you don't have to give information to the police, and you don't have to verbally consent to a search.
Mm-hmm.
If an officer is going to search you anyway, if you don't verbally consent, then that affects your rights later on if there's a court case.
Okay, wow, okay. All right. Okay, so do you think the police force should mirror the community?
I think that's a goal that a lot of police forces have. It's probably one of the reasons that Chicago requires police officers and a lot of other city employees to live within the city limits.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that, if it's not going to mirror the community, then the important thing is to have a lot of training and make sure that police officers are invested in the communities that they serve. What we want is community policing, where police are responsive to the community and the community knows their police.
We had a caller. Caller, if you want to make this really quick, like a 10-second question, this is SCIU Says.
I'd make it real quick. Chicago lead the nation in terms of false confession. And still, enough haven't been done about it. There have been reports done by 60 Minutes. And it still is just like, it's still there. It's still that elephant in the room. And nothing haven't been done about it.
Yeah. And it's one of the reasons that we strongly recommend that I'm happy to come to Know Your Rights trainings at organizations around the city. Let us know. But if you're asked questions, say, I don't want to speak. I want to speak with my attorney.
Right. She's coming back, everybody. She's coming back in May, the second week of May.
Okay.
No, because this is, and it's to be the summertime, and a lot of stuff go down in the summer. And so we just want to make sure we want to have a safe Chicago. Not only want to have a safe Chicago as a country, we want to grow and be the best in the nation. And so, we want to know our rights, and we want to know what to do when things happen. Unfortunately, everyone, we must go. Introduce yourself once again.
Karen Sheely with the ACLU.
All right. And I'm Charlie Bonds. I'm your host today. We thank you for watching another episode of SEIU Says. I want you to have a beautiful weekend, a safe weekend. Tune in next week, same bat time, same bat channel. And I want everyone to be safe, and we will have this conversation again in May. Thank you, everyone.